Hi students, especially students from my own college, Union Law College, Bharati Vidyapeeth University. Today we'll be having this webinar, and in this webinar we'll be giving you details about one of our course, which is Advanced Professional Certificate Course in IPR. I know it's a quite a lengthy name, but it's a very exhaustive course on IPR. It's one of the most exhaustive course on the subject, and we have worked really hard to bring this course to you. So let's start this webinar. So I will be sharing the screen with you. And before we start, I would like to welcome one of our campus ambassador from Union Law College Pune, which is Ayush Jain. And we'll also be joining by Ms. Hina Azhar from the same college. And they will try to ask these questions, ask the question which might be relevant to the question. In the meantime, the students who are watching this webinar and are desirous of, so I think Hina has joined. So as I was saying, that you know, the students who are desirous of asking any questions, they can click on the square box, which is made up of 9 small square box on the top right corner. And then they can ask the questions which will be taken up after the presentation is over. And if you don't have any questions right now, or and you might want to ask any questions later on, then you can always email us, or you can also contact our campus ambassador from the website. So we'll be starting the presentation. So welcome to this webinar, in which we'll be giving you an introduction about Advanced Professional Certificate Course in IPR. So before we start this presentation, I would like to give a brief introduction about myself. I'm a graduate from Union Law College, Bharati Vidyapeeth University, Pune. And prior to founding Fusion Law School, I used to work for SSRN and Company, which is an IP boutique firm. And I, during my stint over there, I have advised many Fortune 500 clients on various contentious and non-contentious issues relating to trademark, copyright, and trade. I have also represented many of them before various courts across India. So we'll start by giving a brief introduction about Fusion Law School. Fusion Law School was founded with an objective to bridge the gap between what is requirements of the legal profession and what is actually taught in the law schools. And the reason we have named our institute Fusion, because we want to provide a legal education, which is an amalgamation of theoretical as well as practical aspects of it. And whatever the courses we design, whatever the course services that we provide to students, all of them, and we lay a lot of emphasis upon in enhancing the employability potential of the students. So prior to founding this institute, we had an extensive survey with the legal fraternity and law students, and we tried to understand the reasons behind why there was such a huge gap between the requirements of the legal profession and what is actually taught in the law schools. So the first reason was outdated and obsolete syllabus. So syllabus which most of the law schools are using, they are actually outdated and obsolete. And it actually happens in 2 ways. The first way is, there are a lot of subjects which are of high importance to legal profession, like law related to capital markets or law related to foreign direct investment. But these courses are not taught in law schools, and they don't find a mention in the law school. Now, in the second way, law school curriculum has become outdated, because when they decide that what all will be taught to the students, they just stick to the theoretical aspects. They don't venture out in the practical aspects. A very good example of this would be contract law. Contract law is taught to every law student, but despite this, whether a student after studying contract law is able to draft a simple contract, this is something which is needs to be seen. The second reason is that faculty members we have across India, they don't have considerable experience in the subjects there. So because of this, what happens, students are not able to share practical experience from the faculty members, and faculty members just stick to the teaching the theoretical aspects, whatever is mentioned in the course. And this information is not at all sufficient for law students when they join the profession. And because of this, when they join the profession, they face a lot of problems in understanding the practical aspects. The third reason is faulty evaluation and assessment procedure. The assessment procedure we have at law school, it is faulty at its core, because it only tests the mugging up or memory power of students. It does not evaluate how good a student is actually understanding the provision, how good is at actually applying those provision on day-to-day facts. And in this way, what happened is students who are good at memorizing things are able to score better than students who are not. Now, the fourth reason is lack of soft skills training. So what happens when you join the profession, there's a lot of soft skills that come into picture. But because these soft skills are not taught in the law schools, the lawyers that are passing out from law schools are not professional. Now, let me discuss the solution that has been adopted by Fusion Law. Yeah, sorry for this interruption. So, as I was saying, let's talk about the solution that has been adopted by Fusion Law. So, the first solution that we have adopted is constitution of honorary advisory group. Yeah, hi Hina, can I mute yourself, because a lot of background noise is coming from you. So, let's create a problem. Okay. Yeah. So, as I was saying, so the first solution that we have adopted is constitution of HABM, which is nothing else but honorary advisory board members. So, what we do whenever we decide that we'll be launching a course in a particular field of law, we create an honorary advisory board, which consists of eminent personalities in that particular field. And with the guidance from HABM, we try to come up with a course curriculum which is as per the requirements of the profession. So in this way, you can clearly see we have adequately addressed the first part. Now, the second solution that we adopt is experience level. So what we have done is we have tried to bring in working professionals, people working in IP boutique law firms, so people working in as an in-house IP counsel, and we have tried to bring these people and enable them to teach on a part-time basis. And that's why these working professionals who also have considerable experience are able to share their precious knowledge with the students on the platform that is provided by Fusion. Now, the third solution that we have adopted is simulated evaluation. What is simulated evaluation? Simulated evaluation is a very unique concept in which what we do is the evaluation system we have at place which are part of our course are trying to simulate the environment of legal profession. Okay. So whatever the IP professional is required to do in the profession, we ensure that the students get a hand-on experience of that. Okay. So if an IP professional is required to get a trademark registered by filing TM1 or TM15, we make the law students do that in the course itself. Because if it's required to draft a lot of cease and desist letter, then we also ensure that the students are getting good experience in drafting cease and desist. So in this way, we ensure that whatever the IP professionals are required to do, students are doing this as a part of the course. This benefits students in two ways. First of all, they are able to appreciate what is actually expected out of them when they will be joining the profession. And the second thing is that if they realize that there are certain areas on which they are not so good, they have an opportunity to improve upon those areas in the law school itself. Now, the fourth solution that we have adopted is soft skills training. In this, what we do is we attach a soft skill instructor with every course, and his or her job is to ensure that the adequate soft skills are imparted upon law students.
So in short, fusion of skills is founded with an objective to nurture and develop the employability potential in learning environments. So see, our point is that if on before joining our course, you were not able to get a job, then after joining our course, we should train you in such a way that you are able to get a job. Okay. And if you are able to get a job for saving you 2 lakhs per month, then after joining our course, we should enhance your employability potential and then you can get a better pay. So let us come to the course on which we are giving an introduction, which is Advanced Professional Certificate Course in IPR. So this course covers almost every type of intellectual property, starting from trademarks, patents, copyright, designs, etc. And then this course we offer two tracks. Okay. First is a patent track and the second is a general. So, as I was saying, that because we have designed our courses from a functional perspective, so you very often see in an IP forum that there are two different kinds of things. First kind, you are dealing with every kind of intellectual property except patents. And there is another kind which only deals with patents. Okay. So that's why we have also designed our course in such a way that the participants are able to opt to mutually exclusive tracks. Okay. So patent track is only given to the students who have a technical background and who later on can become a patent agent by passing the cert examination. So this course is a unique opportunity, provides a unique opportunity to learn substantive as well as a procedural law related to that. And the teaching methodology we adopt is quite innovative and quite advanced. So let me come to the point of what you will learn in this course. So first thing you learn is step-by-step procedure involved in registration, protection, and enforcement of various types of intellectual. Okay, and the second thing that you will be able to do is able to formulate and implement IP protection strategies. Okay, so nowadays what happens is that the clients don't come to the lawyers just for legal advice. Now they have sometimes come to the lawyers asking advice, which is an amalgamation of legal as well as commercial advice. So if a client comes to you and say, I have been facing a lot of counterfeiting and infringement products, so what kind of strategy should I adopt that this kind of situation does not arise altogether? So you will be able to understand their problems, and after studying this course, you will be able to formulate and implement IP protection strategies for the people. Then you will also be learning the key concepts behind IP valuation. We'll also be understanding the concepts involved in IP monetization and branding strategies. Then you will have a practical insight in IP due diligence. We'll also learn how to appreciate complex legal and commercial issues involved in IP infringement. And then you'll also learn domain name dispute resolution. See, this part is proof of the fact that how much practice oriented we are. See, being a domain name, which is like www.xyz.com, is not an intellectual property. But despite that, most of the IP firms in India are practicing domain name dispute resolution. So that's why we want to ensure that student passing out of our courses are able to perform well in an applicable firm. We have included domain name dispute resolution also as a part of our course. Okay. Then we'll also be learning the interaction of intellectual property rights with other fields of law, such as competition and systems. So what are the special features of this course? The first special feature of this course is that this course has been designed after extensive consultation with prominent names in IP. So if I say that the advisory board we have their cumulative experience is more than 150 years. You can probably visit our website and see in detail what the profile of our advisory. Now, the second special feature is that all the lectures are delivered by practicing professionals having considerable experience in that. We are proud to say that not in a single faculty in our institute is not a working professional. All of them are working professionals and have considerable experience in the subjects that they teach. The third advantage is that our course is most exhaustive and comprehensive course in IPR available to students as of now. So the fourth advantage is we don't have outdated evaluation system. Okay. Students are allowed and even sometimes encouraged to use books or internet during assessment and examination. Okay. All the assessments and examinations can be submitted online, and there is no requirement for physical or contact basis. Okay, now let me give a brief introduction to the faculty which will be teaching this course. So on the first, we have Dr. Shilpa Godra. She is a partner and head of trademarks at Lakshmi Kumara Siddharan, which is obviously a very prominent firm. Then we have Mr. Rakesh Prabhu, who is a partner at LMP. Then we have Ms. Sapna Sundar, who is CEO of IPR, again an IP firm. And she's also a published author on IP Smart Work. Then we have Mr. Tushar Kale. He's the owner of Tushar Talks, a firm specializing in IPR and cybermark. Then we have Ms. Mini Walker. She's senior manager at Shrey Infrastructure Finance. Then we also have Mr. Vivek Ranjan, who's senior associate at Singh & Singh, Lal & Singh. Okay. Now I would like to give an introduction to the honorary advisory board, which is attached with us. So first we have Mr. Amarjit Singh. He's the founding and managing partner at Amarjit Singh Energies. He was also one of the founding partners of Anand and Anand, and he left Anand and Anand in the year 1999 and started his own. Dr. Shinder Vora is attached to us as a board capacity. She is a honorary advisory board member and she is also a faculty. Then we have Ms. Susha Pandey, who is a partner and patent attorney at Krishna Trust. We have Mr. Tarun Purana, who is a co-founding partner at Purana & Purana, IP consulting, who is also a very big name in the IP profession. Then we have Mr. Prabhu Pandey, who is a partner at Future. Then we have Mr. Rahul Dev, who is co-founder and managing partner at Technoprop Legal LLC, which is a firm specializing in IPR, corporate, and cyber laws. Then we have Mr. Gupta Kambi, who is a partner at Archer & Venture. Then we have Mr. Ramal Dabbe, who is managing partner at Cyber Jones. Then we also have Mr. Amitabh Chakraborty, who is an IPR, space law, and technology consultant. Based out of India, US, and EU. And then we also have Mr. Tarun Gandhi, who is a partner at Chetra and Chetra IP. This is again a very prominent IP. Thank you. Also, one thing I would like to say that the cumulative experience of all the advisory board members that we have is more than 150 years. And with their guidance, we have tried to come up with the course curriculum, which is as per the requirements of the IP profession, and which covers almost every aspect of intellectual property, starting from trademarks to patents, IPs to domain skills, IP value, IP monetization, IP valuation. They have covered almost every aspect of intellectual property in this course. So, why our online certificate? This is a question that pops in every student's mind. So, when it comes to online certificate, this is not waste your time by listening that you can study everywhere, anytime, at your pace. These are the advantages of online certificate. And we are no exception to this. But they, in addition to these, we offer n number of other additional advantages. First is I just get this question a lot from students, like whether the online certificate course will add value to my CV, will it look good to my CV? So, this prompts a very basic question, like why educational qualification has to happen. So, if you think about this topic, you'll understand that an educational qualification, like a degree from National Law School Bangalore, or a degree from IIT Mumbai or IIT Delhi, why they are better than having a degree from other courses, from a degree from other colleges or universities. There are two reasons. The first one is that because it is hard to get into such institutes. IIT Delhi employers appreciate a degree from IIT Delhi because they understand and they appreciate that how hard it is to get into IIT. But the second reason why these courses have value is that the education provided at these institutes. So IIM Ahmedabad, courses have value. Not only because it is very difficult to get into IIT, but it is also the quality of education that is very good. Okay, but when you take this concept and apply this on certificate courses or diploma courses, then you find a very startling difference. The main difference is that when you're talking about diploma courses, the first factor completely gets out of picture, because anyone from any college can get into a diploma course or a distance learning course provided by LSI and NARS or HEM. So even the employers understand that getting into these courses, you need not have any requisites, knowledge, skills. So the only value, when you're deciding upon whether which course should I go for, the only criteria you should have in mind is the education provided at such a school. Because, for an employer perspective, because I have been on the other side of it, it does not matter whether you have done some diploma course from a particular college. The only thing it matters to him is that they show that the student has some interest in the subject, he has some skill in the field, and this shows that he may stick in this particular field. So now this also asks another question: who decides whether an educational qualification has value? The answer to this question is employers, and employers. Okay. So my question to everyone who says that the courses offered by Fusion Law School might not have value is whether legal professional in what is the courses designed and taught by the prominent names of the profession or any other education. Because even legal employees are aware of the fact that education is provided at law schools are not sufficient. So how will they feel that the certificate courses which are diploma courses which are provided at these schools at this institute will be of any difference? The second advantage that we get after involving in this course is mentorship and placement assistance. So this is a well-known fact that legal profession is extremely valuable. You can appreciate this thing by understanding like how difficult it is for you to get an unpaid internship in good law firms. Then you can really estimate the level of competition that you'll be facing when we approach these firms to get a well-paid job. So thus, my advice to every student should be this: before you do anything in the law school, you should ask these two questions. Whether I will learn something useful, whether after doing this particular activity, whether after publishing this paper, whether going for this new course, whether going for this internship, or whether pursuing this particular diploma or certificate, whether I will learn something useful. Now the second thing is whether it will help me get a good job. So but the problem is that most of the students are not aware of answers to these questions. But an adequate mentorship can substantially increase the chances of it. I would like to state a personal experience. So during my college time, I was very interested in doing internships. And I have done internships with almost all the prominent offers like JSA, AZP, Mission Design Associates, UI Associates. But I made a very crucial mistake that in the last year of my fifth year, I did internship with only prominent and top 10 law firms. The disadvantage of this was that the kind of competition I used to face, it was so huge that I was not able to secure a PR. If somebody would have advised me otherwise, I would have gone for IPR law firms or not so prominent law firms, then I would have a better chance of getting a PR. So this kind of internship, this kind of student-specific advice can substantially increase your chances. Okay. And that's why one of our initiated Jumpstart campaign. So Jumpstart is actually a job portal and professional networking website, which is exclusively dedicated to legal practitioners. And Jumpstart has various insights like what gets student hired, how you should draft your CV, and which kind of CV works better. So Jumpstart has this kind of practical insight. So it has been closely watching the hiring and how insurance and associates are actually selected. So these insights can be used by Jumpstart in order to enhance the career of the students who will be enrolled in the programs. So as I said earlier, also we counsel and help students with career advice. Okay. And one other advantage is that most of our advisory board members have agreed to take interns from our business and offer jobs if they are satisfied with them. Okay. However, we should keep this in mind that we do not guarantee that you will get a job. Obviously, this mainly depends upon how hard you are willing to work, and what your experience has been prior to joining the course as well. However, we ensure you that if you are willing to work hard, you try our level best, we ensure that you succeed. So, why a course in IPR? So, I get this question a lot. Nowadays, most of the students I interact with, they always want to go into corporate. And similarly, when I was in the law school, I wanted to go into corporate. But see, the problem is that it's not like that corporate law firms or corporate houses are not ready. However, the demand of these organizations is so less and the supply is so huge, it actually surpasses its money. It is actually very difficult to get into corporate law firm or corporate house. So, keeping a backup option never hurts. So, and it actually personally helped me as well, because when I wanted to join the corporate world, I kept IPR as a backup option. I also used to pursue CS as well. But when I was not able to get a job in a corporate law firm, I was easily able to rely upon my backup option and secure a decent job. Then the question is, why IPR? Why not some other industry? I will tell you the reason that IPR is the safest and the best to keep as a backup option. The reasons are manyfold. First reason is that a backup option should be relatively easy. Okay, so backup option should not be as hard that it is taking as much time as your main option. But it should be relatively easy. But at the same time, it should provide adequate employment opportunities. And when you're talking about IP boutique firms are most important. Okay. Another example of would be that if you look at the top 10 overall firms of India, there's only one IP boutique firm. There's only one boutique firm, and which actually specialization in IP. IP is a field, it's such a field on which a firm can solely and surely success. So there's a lot of employment opportunities over there. Now let me just come to the board summary of the advanced professional certificate course in India. So the fees of the course is very less, 6,999. And the duration of the course is 1 year. And the next class will be starting on September 13th. And the effort that you will require to put in will be about 2 to 3 hours. Okay, so I'm getting this question a lot. I know that their exams are coming up. So whether we should enroll in this course right now or should wait for the next time. So I would like to tell you that, you know, this is a self-paced course. We do have live session or a periodic paper. So if you have exams in, like, say, October or November, you can easily leave this course for the 2 months, and after passing your examination, you can come back to this course and you can start. You can start from wherever you have. So you should not wait for the next batch. You can easily enroll it now. Numbers is self-paced course. You can leave it whenever you have final examinations or some other internship or some other thing. And the examination that will be conducted in this course will also be flexible. So we conduct 4 examinations in a year. So if you're not able to attend one examination, you can surely attend this course. So there is no possibility of date clash with your semester examination or any other plan. So at the end, I would like to give credit for this webinar to our campus ambassador, which is Ms. Meena Asma and Mr. Ayush Janpati. Without their help and effort, this webinar would not have been possible. So now we would like to take the questions that you guys have asked.
Sir?
Yeah, hi Aishan. Do you have any questions?
Sir, I want to know what is the courses, means what sort of paper are going to be conducted, and what's the way to take the test, and what sort of procedure we have to follow for giving the test, and means we have to go to give online or some written test we have to do?
See, Aishan, that's a very nice question. See, what will happen is that you will be having 2 kinds of evaluation in this course. First one is assessment, and the second one is final examination. So
okay,
what happens is that in order to have assessment, you will be given some quizzes. After every chapter, there will be some quizzes, there will be some multiple choice questions, there can be some subjective questions as well. And there will be a lot of drafting exercises part of this course. Okay. So whenever you learn how to actually draft PM1 or PM51, you will be actually required to do those things, and then you will be evaluated on these. These will be the part of assessment. Once you complete the course, there will be a final examination, which will be a combination of multiple choice questions and subjective questions, and students have to score at least 50% to pass the examination, and the students who secure more than 75% in the first attempt, they will be given a certificate of distinction. I hope I was
okay, sir. So there will be no internal sort of examination. There will be only assessment.
It's not like they have to be submitted right then and there. You'll be given a week's time to submit the assessments.
Okay.
Assessment can be any type of quizzes, assignments, drafting exercises, and providing legal opinion. So our assessment will be nothing else but a simulation of legal profession. So whatever the legal professionals are required to do, will ensure that students are doing this as a part of this course.
Hello. Hello, sir.
Yeah, hi, Ina.
Sir, I have a question that how classes will be conducted? Will there be any schedule or timetable, or any time we can attend the virtual classes?
See, all the classes are really conducted online, and that's clear right now. See, what will happen that we'll be uploading video lectures, and that you can access
okay.
whenever and wherever you have time. all in addition to these, we'll be also having some live class sessions. Okay, so these live sessions will always be on Saturday and Sundays, and they will be predetermined. So, and the students will be informed about them well in advance, and this will be mentioned in the announcement section, which comes on the top of our learning management system. So, it's like a self-paced course, but on periodic intervals, we'll be having live sessions. And these live sessions will be recorded. So, unfortunately, if you're not able to attend this live session, you can surely watch the video of it. But we highly encourage our students to attend these live sessions, because over there they have an opportunity to interact with, have a face-to-face interaction with the faculty members, and clear their whatever doubts or queries, concerns they have about them.
So.
Yeah,
sir. I have one thing. Those students, generally we see the presentation only on the way of Saturday and Sunday. We have the live conference with us, sir.
Yes.
But on the remaining days, sir, working days, sir, if we have some doubt, how to clear those doubts?
See, for that we have a doubt clearing section. So what you need to do is that if you have any doubt, you are supposed to send it to us, and we have a time frame of replying to those doubts within 24 hours.
And second thing, sir, I want to know what's the difference means between the online fusion law course of IPR and the diploma course of intellectual property. Like, what's the basic thing that is different from on this part?
See, certificate courses are provided by private institutes, okay, and diploma courses are provided by educational bodies like colleges or universities, okay. So, because we are an institute, we can provide certificate courses. We cannot provide actually diploma course. But you know, as I told you earlier also, it doesn't matter whether you are doing a diploma course or whether you are in a certificate course. Because for employers, the only thing they care about is whether you have the requisite knowledge about the subject or not. Okay. Whether you are doing from a diploma course from NSI or Bangalore, and whether you are doing a diploma course from some other college, more or less it does not matter much for legal employers' perspective.
So, means on your part, you are saying, sir, ki that the thing which we do in our diploma courses, the same thing we are going to learn, and it's almost the equivalent to our diploma courses.
See, there will be much more than diploma courses. There's a very obvious reason behind it. See, you can see how integrated our course is with the profession. Okay, and that is one of the distinguishing factors we have. Of course, what happened in diploma courses, that is, you have an educational institute. Okay. And it's providing LLB degree. On the side, they started providing diploma courses. But what is the difference in diploma courses? The same faculty they have for the law college, the same faculty is only going to teach in the diploma courses. Okay. And the same faculty, and with that faculty, the same problems will be there that we have discussed in the earlier part of the presentation. But in this course, what will happen is, you will be learning a practical aspects of law from, you know, persons who are working in prominent IP firms, and they will be teaching you the practical aspects in a systematic way. Okay, so the training that you will be getting at our institute will be much better than a regular diploma course, because it will be more or less similar like the training a senior lawyer gets, junior lawyer gets from a senior lawyer. But these things will be provided in a systematic manner, and you will be given an adequate opportunity to hone the skills, hone the knowledge and the skills that you have learned in these courses. So, I think,
I have a question that will the students will be provided with modules, written material?
No, unfortunately, we do not provide any written material. This is a very obvious reason behind it, that because we mainly rely upon video lectures as a mode of imparting education, because we realize that students doesn't like to read that much. Okay, and when somebody is reading in front of them, it is better for them to concentrate, and it is easier for them to comprehend whatever is being taught to them. So that's why we have heavily relied upon training through video lectures. So that's why we do not provide any physical study material, and the students can come online and have access video lectures, they can probably make notes while these lectures are delivered to them, and then they can access these things. And in addition to these, our faculty members will be suggesting them a lot of suggestive reading, and these readings that you can do, and this will further help you to enhance your knowledge. Yeah, so Arushen, do you have any further doubts?
Hello, no sir, thanks
yeah.
A lot.
Thanks Hina, and thanks Arushen for your time. We hope you can do this some other time as well. Okay guys, thanks for, okay. We highly appreciate that you, the efforts both of you has put in this webinar. Okay guys, bye.
Thank you.